Top. cross into eternity. Your grace finds me. Yes, your saints and for the sinner, enough for this whole wide world, your great grace, oh such grace.
Good morning and welcome to Redeemer Bible Church this morning. We are delighted that you have chosen to worship with us, whether this is your first time or maybe you've been watching us for a long time. And you will continue to be watching us for a few more weeks online before there's any opportunity to come back in person. So we are just glad that you are here. We trust that you will engage your heart and in your mind this morning as we worship through song, through giving, through the message this morning. We pray that God would be glorified and that you would be encouraged this morning. So join with us as we sing these songs together this morning. I hope, I know that you really appreciate the worship team, but I really appreciate them. And I want to welcome back Rebecca Mason. She is here after being at Guelph, finishing her third year there. So she'll be with us all summer and leading a fair bit. And I also want to, Julie Broomer on piano. I know sometimes you can't tell who's playing piano and who isn't, but I'll tell you now, you won't see Julie behind there probably for a little while, because Julie is expecting her third little baby girl soon, and so we want to wish her and Tim well and expect those that great news soon. So enjoy her this morning, because that'll be it for a little while. So let's go with this great song.
Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge.
Thank you.
are Lord of all. Through any storm or trial that we face, God, you are our rock that we count on, that we depend on. Lord, help us to give our lives to you for the first time or more strongly today, that we believe those truths. We want to worship you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, worship team, for sharing with us this morning, and I hope you at home were able to engage in worship as well. So a couple of things that we have coming up here at Redeemer. One thing that I am especially excited about is VBS. So last summer we did a fully virtual VBS, and this summer I am really hoping and praying that we will be able to host some of our kids in person this year. So VBS is just under 2 months away. It is the first week of July. And we will be having that hopefully here at the church, but you can continue to pray for that. So that's for all kids from kindergarten up until grade 5. And if you are over grade 5, we'd love to have you help out. And that includes people up to 100 years old. So if you are from grade 6 to 100, we need you to volunteer. So if you are interested, please email me. My email is louisa@redeemerbible.ca, and I'd love to help you help us out this summer. We are going to be having a meeting for all volunteers on Tuesday, June 1st. It's going to be on Zoom at 7 p.m. So even if you're maybe just thinking, we'd love to have you join us and hear a little bit more about what our plan is for this summer. Our theme is Roar, learning about that life can be wild, but God is good in all things. And we know that's really true, and we hope that's the message that our kids will hear this summer and just be reminded that as in really crazy times, we're in kind of a crazy season right now, but God is good. So we are going to be doing that. And if you are interested in volunteering, please join us at our Zoom meeting. We also are going to be collecting our offering this morning virtually. So there are a couple of options. You can mail it in, but we also have online giving as well. And we're thankful for the faithful stewardship of your gifts through your offering. And we hope that you will continue to partner with us so that we can carry out our ministries like VBS. And we're really thankful for that. I'm going to take a moment to pray, and then the worship team has one more song for us today. Father God, thank you for this Sunday, for this opportunity we have to gather online, and for technology for allowing us to be able to do this. And God, I just pray that you will open our hearts to hear from you today. I pray especially for those from our Redeemer family who may be struggling and have different needs. I pray for them, God. I pray that you will strengthen them. I thank you especially for Cheryl McDonald for finishing up her treatment. And I pray that you will just continue to heal and restore her body, and that you will just bless her in this time. And I pray for others who may be struggling, who we are aware of or who may we not be aware of. I pray for them, especially for seniors, God. Will you comfort them and remind them that they are loved by you, and help them to just ease their loneliness in this time, God. And I pray for Pastor Carl as he prepares to speak later this morning, that you will give him words to say, and that he will just speak a message that comes from you, Lord. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, the worship team wants to do one more song before Pastor Carl comes and gives the message this morning. The words of this song are just encouraging us to be still before the Lord. In these turbulent times, he promises us rest, and we just need to come before him. And so hopefully these words will encourage you this morning.
Leads to Well, good morning, Redeemer, and all those joining us from everywhere, now that it's online. We're continuing our look this morning at the first book of Samuel, and we're on to chapter 15. So read with me, 1 Samuel 15, verses 10 to 23. The word of the Lord came to Samuel. I regret that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me and has not performed my commandments. And Samuel was angry, and he cried to the Lord all night. And Samuel rose early to meet Saul in the morning. And he was told Samuel, Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he has set up a monument for himself, and turned and passed on and went down to Gilgal. And Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said to him, Blessed be you to the Lord, for I have performed the commandment of the Lord. And Samuel said, What then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears and the lowing of the oxen that I hear? Saul said, They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God, and the rest we have devoted to destruction. Then Samuel said to Saul, Stop, I will tell you what the Lord said to me this night. And he said, Speak, said to him, Speak. And Samuel said, Though you are little in your own eyes, are you not the head of the tribes of Israel? The Lord anointed you king over Israel, and the Lord sent you on a mission and said, Go, devote to destruction the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them till they are consumed. Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Why did you pounce upon the spoil and do what was evil in the sight of the Lord? And Saul said to Samuel, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. I have gone on the mission on which the Lord sent me. I have brought Agag, this is the king of Amalek, and I have devoted the Amalekites to destruction. But the people took of the spoil, sheep and oxen, and the best of the things devoted to destruction, to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. And Samuel said, Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to listen than fat of the rams. For rebellion is as the sin of divination, and presumption is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he also has rejected you from being king. So from this point on, from Samuel 15 on, Saul is a dead man walking. He may be king in office, but his approval as king and his authority as king has been removed by God. From now on, you will see Saul desperately trying to cling to a crown that is not his. He'll be fighting a losing battle against God and Samuel and David for the rest of his life. Now, what we find in the chapters leading up to this that we skipped over is that Saul has proven to be very clever, a great tactician, a good general, occasionally compassionate, very charismatic, a good strategist, a good leader. But he has failed as a spouse. He is not very attentive as regards his relationship with God. And this indictment comes here in chapter 15 as being kind of the last straw. God shows up and says he has not obeyed the commandments, plural. Saul is concerned with commandment, singular. But so God is saying, this is typical. Saul has a pattern, and I have to reject him as king because I can't work through somebody who won't listen to me. And as a result, we see here the problems that lead to Saul's fall. And ultimately, the problem is this. Saul becomes exactly what he loves. Saul becomes what he delights in. And we see, tragically, the process of how he gets there. And it starts with him not knowing what delights God. And then, from there, it's logical that he doesn't know what will delight himself. He doesn't delight in God. And then, when those two things are in place, when he doesn't know what God delights in, and he doesn't himself delight in God, he is free to, unfortunately, become exactly what he wants to become. And that's the tragic fall of Saul. And as we look at the story, we're going to look at those three things and hopefully come to understand not just what happens to Saul, but what can so easily happen to us and hopefully help stave off the same fate. So let's begin with the fact that he doesn't know what God delights in. He doesn't know what delights God, what makes God happy. So I'll start with a story. Let's go back to May 1995. The Port Credit baseball team, this high school team, is playing the Applewood A's in Mississauga. And Port Credit is down by one run late in the game, two runners on base, no outs, and up comes a strapping young man named Carl. I come up to bat, this opportunity to save my team and feeling like I could do it. So I step into the batter's box with one foot out, and I look at my third base coach, who is our coach, Mr. Mahalis. If he's listening to this, thank you for the story. Mr. Mahalis is there, and he does what third base coaches do. He starts doing these elaborate signs. He's pulling on his earlobe. He's brushing the brim of his hat. He's doing everything. And I nod in approval as if I have any idea what he's saying. But I didn't bother to learn the signals. So he's making these motions, and I nod as if I know what he's saying. Now, he had been telling me to bunt, which was a very shrewd, strategic move. Two runners on base, no outs. The right move is to bunt, sacrifice my at-bat, and let those runners advance into scoring position. Makes sense. I, however, don't have a clue what he wants from me. So I nod, so I don't look stupid, and I get up there. First pitch comes, high fastball, I swing and I miss. I look at the third, I look at Mr. Mahalis, and he's just staring at me with his eyes wide open, because he's expecting me to bunt, and I'm swinging like I'm Babe Ruth. And he looks at me, and he's like, maybe I didn't see it. So he looks wide-eyed, and he goes really slow. He starts doing the motions again slower, just because he thinks maybe I didn't see it. And I nod. I still have no idea what he wants me to do. So the second pitch comes, and I swing and miss again. And at this point, I look at my poor coach, and he throws his arms in the air and walks into the dugout. He just leaves. Because to his mind, I either don't know the signs, or I'm intentionally doing something that he doesn't want me to do, in which case, he's not interested in me. So he leaves, and I realize, okay, I'm in trouble, so I better do something. So the next pitch comes, and contrary to all logic, I swing on the third straight pitch, but this time I hit it, and I hit a beautiful, beautiful shot, a nice low-line drive. It actually hits the fence. I hit a stand-up triple. We are now winning by a run. I then get batted in. When I go into the dugout, my teammates are high-fiving me. Some are laughing at me because they know I don't know anything. I get to Mr. Mahalis, and he says and does things to me that today would get him probably fired. But he drags me outside, and he says, what were you doing? And I said, I didn't know the signs, so I just hit. And I said, but why are you complaining? We're winning now. I did it. Like, calm down, coach. And he smacked my helmet, actually, off my head. And he said to me, Carl, I didn't want you to hit a triple. I wanted you to listen to me. That's what I wanted from you. And he then substituted me, and I did not finish that game, even though I had technically won it. And he was right. And the reason I bring that up is this is the sad situation Saul finds himself in. Saul justifies himself. He says, listen, I know God has sent me in this occasion. He has sent me to go and wipe out the Amalekites. And we're going to talk at the end about how brutal that request is from God. But he says, I know God said, wipe them out and take nothing from them. But come on, Samuel. If I did that, then all those wonderful things would have been spoiled. They would have been destroyed in the war. But now I've taken them out and the people want them. But you know what? We'll sacrifice them to God. And it'll be good. Isn't it better that we sacrifice it and it's used for something good? And Samuel rebukes him in verse 22 by saying the words that kind of center this entire sermon. Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? You see, he is basically telling Saul, you don't know what he wants. Much like Carl didn't know what Mr. Mahalis wanted, because I haven't bothered to listen to him. Neither did Saul know exactly what would please God. He didn't know. So he was left to assume what would please him. And the reason he didn't know what would please God is because he didn't listen. And I know that we know that that's what God is trying to say in this passage. Because in chapter 15, the Hebrew word shema, which means listen or hear, shows up 7 times. So it's clear if you trace and underline on your own time all those different instances of hearing or listening, you're going to notice something. Saul is being told by God and Samuel, you are not listening to us. Saul, of course, is insisting, like I did, no, I did a good thing. I listened. I know what you're doing. I'm still killing everything. I'm still destroying it. I'm just doing it on my own timeline. That's all right, right? And God keeps saying, you're not listening to me. You don't know what I want. And this is kind of logical. If you think about when you met your spouse, or if you have a boyfriend or a girlfriend, and you spent those moments when you first meet them on the phone or talking to them, you ask them all these questions. You know, you say things like, how do you take your coffee? What do you put on your nachos? Like, all these sorts of, you ask all these questions. You want to know everything about the person. And the reason is that person fascinates you, and you want to know everything about them. But notice, you want to know everything about them so that you know how to delight them. because you want to be able to get them the perfect gift. You want to meet them after a hard day at work and be able to give them exactly what will make them feel satisfied, refreshed, happy. You want to delight them, so you listen to them. And Saul has not taken the time to delight in God. He hasn't taken the time to listen. And we know that there's a distance here. And I said it to you before, and he says it twice in this passage we just read. Saul always refers to God as the Lord, your God. You notice that? He never says the Lord, my God. There's always this distance between Saul and God. And because he hasn't listened to God, it's no wonder that he doesn't realize that God doesn't want Saul's stuff. He wants Saul. And because Saul doesn't understand what makes God happy, he is always miscalculating what sacrifices are. He's always missing the mark. Because he's under the impression that a sacrifice is about giving something. But God is saying, no, a sacrifice is about costing you something. And there's a subtle difference. In chapter 13, which we haven't read, there's a story that if you're a Christian, you've heard many times, but it's simple enough to explain. Israel is going to battle, to war. And Saul is told, go to war, but do not start the battle until Samuel has come and made an offering. When that has happened, then you go to war. So Saul is waiting and waiting. But Samuel, some people think he's doing it just to be a bit of a jerk. But we don't know. But Samuel's taking his time. He's not showing up. So when Saul starts to feel a little anxious, his people start leaving him. And his decision is, you know what? I've got to make the offering. I can't go to war without making the offering, so I've got to do it. And he makes the sacrifice, missing the point. He thinks what God wanted was the offering. But what God wanted was the cost of faith that Saul was asked to show. Saul was asked to say, to wait, hold on for Samuel, trust that God will bring him, and if he doesn't, don't trust in your ability to give a sacrifice, trust that God will care for you. See, the sacrifice wasn't the lambs and the oxen. The sacrifice was Saul's faith. Would he trust God or not? And then the second one here in verse chapter 15, the same thing happens. They go to this war, and they are told to destroy everything. But you have to understand, in the ancient world, soldiers weren't usually paid very much, almost nothing. So the payment they got was from the spoil. When you won a war, you could do whatever you wanted with the people and their property. So when Saul says, hey, we're going to fight the Amalekites, but you're going to get nothing, the people seemingly got pretty upset and said, what do you mean we're not going to get anything? Then why am I risking my life? And then, so Saul says, fine, take the stuff, but we'll sacrifice some to God. Now, in that instance, Saul is saying, we'll end up giving it to God. We'll just modify it a little. And what God is saying is, I didn't want you to give me the best of the stuff, Saul. I didn't want you to hit a triple for me, Saul. What I wanted was for you to be willing to even risk your reputation amongst your soldiers and say, you're getting nothing and we're going to trust God for this because he says so. And risk the fact that you may not be popular, that you may even have to fight this battle alone. Would you go that far in trusting me, Saul? Will this sacrifice cost you something, or is it just going to cost the Amalekites something? And Saul continually falls for the old lie that the gift is what God wants, as if he needs lambs and oxen. And he keeps missing the point, because sacrifice requires self-denial. And for Saul, that's a price that is too high. And for many people, it's too high to offer. Because a sacrifice means seeing beyond the personal cost and into the delight that it brings the other. Are you able to see that your cost, as great as it might be to you, is actually nothing in comparison to the delight it will bring the one you are sacrificing it for? If you go back to the way we relate to our spouses, there was once upon a time where you treated your husbands and wives that way, where you thought, I'll get up at 4 a.m. and get you a drink of water, no problem. Now, how many years I've been married, 18 years? Sarah wakes me up at 4 a.m. for a drink of water. I say, you know where the taps are? It's 4 a.m., I'm tired. And that's a bit of a joke. Fortunately, she's never really asked me for a drink at 4 a.m. I haven't had to prove it. But you see, things fade that way. And Saul is never able to give what God demands of him. He's never able to trust God enough for it. And he fails to see that a sacrifice without faith is like giving somebody a laptop without a charger. It's full of potential, but useless, unless the charger, the power for it is there. And the power for sacrifice is found in faith. And Saul never gets it. And I raise this today for us. I think one of the ways I think this applies to us, certainly to me, is I make a lot of decisions throughout the week. some for the church, some for how we run the church, some for money, some for our family, some for our own family's money, all kinds of decisions. I usually think that the right answer is the prudent answer. I think, well, this is the best way to use our money. This is the best way to run the church. And I assume if it starts to be fruitful, then it's okay. I wonder if I spend enough time, and if you spend enough time saying, the prudent isn't really the point. Did I listen to God for every decision I make? Did I sit and actually ask and inquire and bring him into the situation? You see, I wouldn't make a move without asking my wife what she thought about how to do certain things with our family. But I make decisions all the time without asking God. So I'm not, and especially when in Scripture we see continually that God's preference for us is not that we make a prudent choice, but that we make the faithful choice. So as an encouragement, maybe a challenge to us is to ask that question, do we actually ask God if this is the right choice, even if it looks like it makes perfect sense to us? But then we move on. If Saul doesn't know how to delight God, the result is he doesn't actually himself delight in God, because Saul doesn't know what will make him happy. And we see this in the fact that Samuel refers to what he's doing as idolatry. He also calls it divination, but we'll talk about that when we talk later about Saul speaking to the witch of Endor. We're going to cover that later in the series. But when he calls it idolatry, what is idolatry? Idolatry is expecting something to give you what only God can give you. It's very simple. If you expect something to give you something, but only God is the one who can give it to you, then you have made that thing an idol. You've given that thing a position that doesn't belong to it. And what we see in Saul is this pattern. We've just talked about the two sacrifices, the big ones in chapter 13 and 15. And what we find here is Saul continually chases and makes the decisions that will bring him what he most desperately wants, which is security and adoration. We see it here. He's making a monument to himself. We see later how jealously he responds when people seem to be revering David over himself. Saul, throughout his career, shows that he wants the people to give him a sense of value, to give him a sense of loyalty, to make him feel like he belongs. So he's always pandering to the people. He's always doing what he can to secure their favor. And he does it all through so far up until chapter 15. So in chapter 13, he fears, he says directly, I saw the people leaving me, because I hadn't offered a sacrifice, and they didn't want to fight a war without God there. So because they were deserting me, I gave in. You see, because idols always demand a sacrifice. Idols always demand payment and promise you something. And Saul realizes that if he is going to have the loyalty of the people, he must pay them. And what did they want? They wanted that sacrifice done. And in chapter 15, what did they want? They wanted the spoil. And Saul, every time, is saying, yes, yes. He has this chronic disease where he can't stand to not have the favor of the people. So he's always feeding the idol what it needs. Every idol, every god demands payment. And so he finds, of course, that they're insatiable. They'll demand everything from you and never deliver on what they promise. And because he didn't know who God was and what God delighted in, he then starts looking for the people to give him this security. Isn't it interesting that he gives the people everything he can? He breaks every commandment he can to give the people what they want, and the crown is still taken from him. Because the idols never can deliver on what they promise. And he finds it out. And I think the reason he does it is because he's driven more by desperation than by his faith. And I'll explain that very quickly with another much less tragic story. Years ago, I was cutting the grass of my in-laws. We got into their house, and they were having family over, and they were in a bit of a mess trying to get everything done to get the place ready. And I said, what can I do to help? And they said, well, we need the grass cut. And they had a big 3 acres or something. So I jump on the riding mower, and I start to cut the grass. But shortly into it, it runs out of gas. So Redeemer is well aware of the fact that I'm not mechanically skilled in any way. But it's clearly out of gas. That much I did know. So I run into the garage, and I get this jerry can full of gas, and I bring it out and I fill it with gas, and then I put it away. I get back on the mower and start it. A couple minutes in, the mower begins to spew white smoke, and lots of it. So I realize I have put diesel into this lawnmower. Now, why did I do that? One, I'm not intelligent. One is very simple. I don't know the difference, and I still probably couldn't tell you the difference between one. I didn't realize that my father-in-law had put them in different cans, a yellow can for diesel, red for gas, but that's besides the point. The other one is this. This is what I knew. I knew people were coming in a few minutes, and I wanted the place to look good. The desire to get that done meant that I would grab anything that promised to get me what I wanted. Just like a person dying of thirst in the desert is desperate for water, and that desperation may lead them to drink something that promises satisfaction, but isn't water at all. They could drink something that is completely unhelpful and will actually counteract what they're trying to do. Because when you let the desperation drive you, then you're prone to making poor decisions. And I think Saul gets to a spot where his faith was so weak, he had but he had not really trusted God. And as a result, he didn't have this muscle to remind him in desperation to go to God. Instead, he lashes out for anything that promises security, and he finds it doesn't work. So Saul doesn't know what delights God, and as a result, he doesn't know what will make him happy, so he's seeking that happiness and that security and other things. And then we get to this last part. With those two things in place, Saul is tragically free to become exactly what he wants to become. And here we address this very brutal idea of harem. Harem is the Hebrew word for total destruction. It means devoted to God. So God, throughout the Old Testament, specifically in the Canaanite Wars, says, go in and wipe these people out. In fact, in verse 2 of chapter 15, here's exactly what God says, 2 and 3. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I have noted what Amalek did to Israel in opposing them on the way when they came up out of Egypt. Now, go and strike Amalek and devote to destruction all that they have. This is the brutal part. Do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, child and infant, ox and sheep, camel and donkey. This is a very brutal policy. But let me say three things before we get back to Saul, because I don't have time to spend doing apologetics for this, but I will say three things quickly. One, Israel is not the only nation by any stretch that did this in the ancient Near East. There's plenty of archaeological evidence to say lots of people did this. So it's not unique to Israel. That's one. Two, if you are reading this or any part of the Bible and you aren't often, especially when you become an early Christian or if you're a skeptic, if you aren't often forced to sit down, set the Bible aside and say, what? What is going on? Then may I suggest if you've never questioned your God, you don't have a God, you have yourself. Because if God is this ultimate universal being, he's got to disagree with you. He has to, otherwise that would make you God. So if you have a God who only says, that's okay, you've never made a mistake, you're all right, every bad decision everybody says you made, it was a good one. You don't have a God. You're worshiping yourself. And the God of the Bible, we often hear people say, well, you created this God to make life feel easier. I'm sorry, that's an ignorant response. If you want a God that will make you feel good, you don't create the God of the Bible, who thunders from Mount Zion and says, I will by no means acquit the guilty, who says, kill them all, who says, nothing will pay for your iniquity, except for his son. That's not the kind of God I create. See, I create a God who will say, I'm good. Everything I do is good. I don't create a God that says, you're terrible. You're terrible. That's just not the God we create. It's a lie. So that's two things. The last one I'll say is this. I've wrestled with these passages, and I became a Christian at university. And these sorts of things were always on me. Can I try? Like, God is... He's condemning people to hell, and I know people say we send ourselves. Listen, don't let God off the hook. He's sovereign. He made hell. Nobody else made it for him. And yes, we may choose these things, but he is God. He allows it to happen. We can't let him off the hook. He sends people to hell. He allows terrible things to happen. Don't let him off the hook. And the reason you and I struggle with that so much is because you and I don't believe he is sovereign. We actually don't trust God. You know, people will come to me and say, I have intellectual problems with God. I don't know if his morality here with this harem rule is fair. I don't think somebody should be eternally punished for a one-time thing. And they say they have intellectual baggage. Listen, I said the same thing, and I really thought it was intellectual baggage until I realized this. I didn't have a moral problem with what God was saying. What I had a problem with was I didn't believe he was good. I didn't trust him. When he said, this person deserves his fate, my head said, can I trust him to make that decision? Is he equipped to make that? Because I don't know if I trust him. But if I believe that God is who he says he is in the Bible, if I actually know him and pray and read the Bible, have community, serve him, and think about him, the image I get from the Bible is not that he's arbitrary and bullish and brutish, but that he's caring and compassionate, and that I may still be puzzled by his decisions, but ultimately I trust him. So if you're a skeptic or a Christian who's struggling with God, who would allow these things to happen, may I say, stop hiding behind an intellectual lie. It's not true. Your problem is you don't trust him. You don't believe he's good. And if that's the case, wrestle with that. Don't pretend like it's an intellectual question, because it's not, at least not at its root. Now that I've angered everybody, let me move back to Saul. Because Saul is being told this, what we just said, go and destroy everybody. Now, here's what you need to know about the Amalekites. They were not an innocent people, okay? The Amalekites were a nomadic, marauding, brutal people who historically, when Israel was coming out of Egypt, they were in a caravan. And as people at the tail end of the caravan began to get tired and would start to fall behind, the Amalekites would come in and slaughter those stragglers and then loot their bodies and then wait until the next group fell back and then do it again. So they were not, we're not talking about an innocent people here. And God comes to Saul and says, Saul, this is a war of justice, not a war of imperialism. You are not to do what everybody else in the world does with war. Everybody else fights wars to gain something. I want their land, I want their wealth, I want whatever it is you want reputation. And God comes and tells Saul, you're going as an instrument of justice. You're to bring justice to them. You don't take anything from them. You gain nothing from them. This is not the way Israel is to fight a war. You do not fight wars like the rest of the world, Saul. And Saul's response then, in coming and saying, well, I'm going to take the best of the stuff. Notice it's important that the narrator says he took the best and sacrificed the rest to God. He takes the best out of it. So what is Saul doing? See, God isn't just mad because he didn't cross all the T's and dot the I's here. He is upset because he realizes that Saul is becoming just like every other king and that he is driving Israel to become like every other nation. And remember, the point of the entire Bible is God to say, I'm taking this people and I'm going to make them different. They're going to be like me. I'm going to sharpen them. I'm going to shape them into the creatures that look and live like me so that when they delight in me, they will find that they become delighted. And then as they are a delight, the nations will see the delight they have and say, I want it. So the key for Saul was to be a king that heard God and kept Israel as to be the people that God made them to be. So as Saul is slipping and becoming like every other king, God, of course, has to come and say, I can't have it. I can't work through a man whose delight is something other than me. I can't do it. I have to cut him off, if I don't cut him off, then actually the entire world suffers because they'll never know who I am. I have to cut him off. And so we see all of this brought to, I think, its best culmination in a spot, and I won't have it on the screen, so I didn't give the whole amount, but in Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament, in chapter 3, verses 6 to 12, God says this incredible thing, which is so terribly used often from the pulpit, but let me read it first. It says this, for I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore, you, O children of Jacob, are not consumed. From the days of your fathers, you have turned aside from my statutes and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you say, how shall we return? What will a man rob God? Yet you are robbing me. But you say, how have we robbed you? In your tithes and contributions. You are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me and the whole nation of you. Bring the full tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven pour down for you a blessing until there is no more need. I will rebuke the devourer for you so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil, and your vine in the field shall not fail to bear, says the Lord of hosts. Key verse, verse 12. Then all nations will call you blessed, for you will be a land of delight, says the Lord of hosts. And we are horrible preachers, and we make this verse continually about guilting our congregations into giving more money to the church. And we say, trust God, give him more money, he'll fill you up. You give him 10, he'll give you 20. This is a silly way, And I'm holding myself back by calling it silly. It's not the point of this passage. What God is saying to Israel at that time of Malachi, and what he's saying to Saul is this: that thing that you love more than me, which is money for at this point in Israel's life, that thing which rivals God for your heart, give it to God. Whatever it is, it's not money per se. This is the one instance. And God is saying, I don't care about the money. I need you to put me on the throne of that heart. Whatever it is, delight in me, not in the money, not in the acclaim, not in your neighbor's wife, whatever it is, delight in me. And when you delight in me, you will find yourself being delighted. I will throw open the floodgates. I will make you pleased. I will give you the belonging you've longed for. I'll give you the hope you've longed for. But you have to look to me for that, because no other source will give it. And then you see the missional aspect, the evangelistic aspect. When you delight in me, all the nations will call you blessed, for you will be a land of delight. You see, when you delight in God, when you try to delight God, he will fill you with delight, and then the nations will want that same delight. And it's not by accident. God intended it that way. And we get that way by praying together, by hearing God. And then when you listen to God, you really try to hear what's going on in the Bible and pray and be with other Christians, you know what you realize? He's not mean, he's not arbitrary, but the story, the base note that runs through all of the Bible is the gospel. And when you see that God so delights in you that he was willing to give what was most delightful to him for you, he gave up his son, the thing that was his greatest delight. In fact, when he is baptized in the Gospels, the Greek word says, here's my son in whom I delight. God takes what he delights in most and gives it up for you. So that when you look at him, you can start to delight in the God who trusts you, who loves you, who gives you everything that you long for. And when you do that, you then will become a kind of person. The Redeemer will become the kind of church that people will come to, not to seek us, but to seek the one that we delight in. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Saul is and again, I said it before, I'm very conscious of the fact that we may meet these people, and we know you've put them in Scripture to show us what is good and what is right and what is wrong and what is bad. And yet, Lord, we don't slander Saul. We recognize, I think that's the great tragedy we have, is we so recognize and sympathize with him because we see Saul in all of us. Lord, and as we do that, we lay down our crowns at your feet, and we say, Father, where we fail, help us to sacrifice whatever it is we're worshiping for you. Help us to find delight in you, even delight in these hard verses. Lord, we trust you. And where we don't have trust, Father, it's like that man in the Gospels. We believe. Help our unbelief. Lord, help us to see who you are. Help us to see how you delight in us, Father, and show us what it means to be a delight to you. God, we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
How great the through the night, then through the
Well, thank you for joining us this morning. A few announcements before we close things off. The first one is, and there won't be a slide for this, if you attend Redeemer, you know we have this house called Mercy House on the property. And for the next number of weeks, we're going to have a family with parents named Ruth and Ryan there. And that family will be here for a few weeks. They're a missionary family. They have 7 children. They make me look like a slacker. And I don't know what their involvement will be, if they'll be attending or what's going to happen, but let's make sure that they feel welcome. And we say that so you're also praying for them, but also remembering that there's nobody who's broken into the house if you see them using it. So we're just so gracious and so happy to God that he allows us to use the stuff he's given us to serve other people. So Ruth and Ryan, we're excited to have you guys and the kids here. On June 3rd, we have a prayer gathering at 7 p.m., so please sign up and join. Well, not sign up. You will receive a link through the RB Connect and online, so keep your eyes and ears, or whatever parts of you, peeled for that. And then lastly, for Anniversary Sunday, happening on May 30th, a little bit of a change. One, we will not be doing a baptism on that day. We have baptisms and everything, and people want to be baptized. However, we're going to wait until we can gather. You've heard that Premier Ford has extended the lockdown until early June. We really think that baptism is something you're not, you know, the culture makes it sound like you're baptized into Christ alone, but you're baptized into him and into his family, and you're baptized into this community. It's not something that we just want to do for hire. We are just out here baptizing people. We want to baptize into the family, that you're part of this group, and it's something we want to celebrate as a family if we can, as best we can. So we're going to delay that until we can meet. But we are going to be taking up our anniversary offering, and you would have seen it in the RB Connect, that you've, like it or not, you have seen that the digital age is here to stay. We have been forced to go online because of COVID, which I think is probably a good thing, and we're playing catch up to an extent, but we're also realizing that the need to be online and to be doing social media, online classes and videos, and even offering a lot of things that will be both live in person and online, it's not going away. This is an ongoing need the church will have. So we're looking to raise $5,000 to help equip our communications team to do that more effectively. And you can get more information from us if you'd like. And anything that comes in excess of that $5,000, we will allocate to the Benevolent Fund, which goes to continue to help support those in need at Redeemer, but also in the community as well. And just a reminder, if you know somebody who has a need, contact the church. We want to be able to use the Benevolent Fund to help people in need at this time. So thank you. And with that ends the service for this week. We will see you here next week. Have a wonderful week.